A year underwater, and the Calvert Island humpback whale's bones have been picked clean by everything from crabs and snails to fish and worms. Delayed by the COVID pandemic, the bones spent much longer underwater than Mike would have liked, and some damage has occurred. But it's finally time to pack them up and send them southward to Mike's workshop on Salt Spring Island, where he will begin the process of piecing back together this giant puzzle. Next, on Whale Bones. For generations, many Outer Coast First Nations hunted oil-rich humpbacks and other whales along parts of what's now known as the west coast of North America. Beyond providing a source of food, oil, and raw materials for housing and tools, humpbacks were and continue to be of great cultural importance to many of these nations. But they harvested relatively few of these whales compared to the global boom of commercial hunting that followed. In the 19th and early 20th century, the invention of the steam engine and exploding harpoons made whales a much easier target. Humpback numbers plummeted, bringing the whales to near extinction here in BC and around the world. As humpback numbers crashed and the demand for whale blubber and baleen slowed, whaling stations along the British Columbia coast closed one after another until the last one shut its doors in 1967. Just a year earlier, the hunting of humpback whales was banned globally. But it wasn't until 1986 that the International Whaling Commission, an intergovernmental body overseeing whale management, declared a moratorium on all commercial whaling. Today, several international treaties and regulations, along with federal laws, exist to safeguard whales. And marine protected areas and sanctuaries have been designated to conserve key areas used by whales. But protecting these animals is a complex and difficult challenge. Whales don't stay put or pay attention to political borders. They also face numerous threats in today's world of noise and chemical pollution, climate change, and busy waterways. Despite all this, and though their numbers aren't quite what they used to be, humpbacks in most parts of the world, including here in British Columbia, have made an incredible recovery from near extinction. We have a rare second chance with these whales, who we nearly lost.
When I was growing up as a kid, we never saw them. Like they had been really, they're decimated during the whaling years. And then as I was going to university and taking the ferries, I think I saw my first humpback in the Strait of Georgia, sort of around that time. And now, they're a common sight out there. So it's an amazing story of recovery.
The Calvert whale's bones have arrived at Mike's workshop. Some are in need of repair, having spent the last year hanging in nets under the Hakai Institute's dock on Calvert Island. Hungry crabs, fish, and other critters helpfully tease the last bits of muscle and sinew off of the bones, but some also went after the proteins that hold the bone together. Before the bones can be repaired, though, they need to be degreased. Humpback whales have a thick layer of blubber that keeps them warm and serves as a form of energy storage for the long stretches of the year when they generally stop eating. Despite having just returned from the breeding grounds where there is little to no food for humpbacks, this young whale had already built up a good layer of blubber, which was useful to him when he was alive. But having seeped into his bones, the grease will work against their long-term preservation, so they need to be cleaned. The problem is, the bones are huge, and there are a lot of them. Fortunately, Mike has a deep cleaning solution parked just down the road. Unique in all the world, Mike has repurposed a massive stainless steel tank previously used to clean aircraft engines and helicopter transmissions, and filled it with close to 400 liters of a proprietary solvent that he sets to boil. The humpback bones sit in a basket above the boiling liquid, while the solvent's hot vapor wafts up and melts the grease, which drips out of the skeleton. It takes multiple batches and roughly 2 weeks to degrease all of the bones, but they are now ready for repairs. Mike and his team set to gluing together bits of bone and painting some of them with a resin that will soak in and harden the bones, so they'll survive the rebuild and last for years to come.
articulating skeletons, and particularly with these whales, there are a lot of different skill sets that come together. There's the pure biological aspect and the anatomy, and then of course you have to have the practical skills of dealing with a massive animal on the beach and how you get it, take it apart and clean all the bones. And then there's a lot of sort of engineering and planning. I built houses with my dad as I was growing up. He was a builder. And so I, learned how to read architectural plans and do all of that. So when we go to install these into museums, we have to sort of think very spatially about the place the skeleton's going to be going. And then comes sort of the more sort of imaginative or artistic aspect, where you have to sort of put yourself inside the brain of the whale and like imagine what this animal is going to be doing and how you want to display it.
Because so much of humpback whales' lives are spent underwater, beyond our view, looking at the remains of hunted and beached whales used to be the main way we were able to learn about them. These dead whales taught us quite a bit about humpback anatomy, life history, and what they like to eat. But they revealed almost nothing about humpback behavior, social interactions, communication, or a million other aspects of these whales' lives. Over the last decades, though, several breakthroughs in research techniques have pushed our understanding of humpbacks forward by leaps and bounds. In the 1970s, scientists had an incredible realization. Each humpback whale has a unique trailing edge to their fluke, along with a pattern of markings on the fluke's underside, a fingerprint of sorts. Suddenly, they could identify individuals and distinguish one humpback from another. Photo catalogs began filling up with named whales. And from this simple understanding came so many new ones. Now, researchers are able to track local and far-ranging movements of specific whales as they travel between locations at different times of the year. We can now talk about social structures, track lifespans, populations, and all kinds of other insights, all with just a pair of binoculars and a good camera. Alongside this revolution in whale research, scientists began using various types of tags that allow them to track the movements of individual whales, along with other kinds of information, like diving depths. The tags are invasive, though, so researchers have to weigh knowledge and conservation gains from the use of tags against their potential impacts. Underwater microphones now allow us to eavesdrop on humpback communication and the soundscape the whales inhabit. The use of drones by permitted scientists to measure body size, read vital signs, and collect blow and fecal samples to measure the health and register the genetics of individuals has changed what we can learn about humpbacks and their hidden lives. Although it appears the Calvert humpback was never included in a photo catalog, every little bit that we learn from his remains contributes to a better understanding of humpbacks here on the British Columbia coast and around the world. And every little bit counts because there's so much left to understand about these wondrous animals. But for now, Mike is focused on prepping the Calvert whale's bones and planning the next important step. Before he can start putting the pieces of the supersized puzzle back together, Mike is going high-tech. With the help of a few experts, Mike will scan every single one of the whale's bones. Then, thanks to 3D software akin to the latest gaming tech, we'll get our first glimpse of the bones as they come together in a virtual world. On the next episode of Whale Bones.